Well, Connie, first, you know the old Jewish joke about what happened when the people saw what happened? They rushed forward to get souvenirs autographed by God. I mean, can you imagine what that would get you on eBay?
Yeah.
And the story is the rich and powerful pushed to the front. They got the fragments that said kill, steal, commit adultery. And the poor people were left with the leftovers which said thou shalt not.
Yeah.
No, but what Moses does at that point, he realizes that God expected too much of people. People don't have the capacity to always do the right thing, especially these people. Up until a few weeks ago, they were slaves.
Yeah.
They don't know how to exercise free will. So Moses shatters the tablets, goes back up the mountain, and the second set of tablets, the first set were inscribed originally by God, the second set are a joint human-divine partnership. They are the same standards, the same insights about how human beings are meant to live, but now they are phrased as an ideal and not as a demand. Not the expectation of perfection, but the recognition. Human beings may strive to improve, but they can never be perfect. And once Moses accepts the insight, you cannot expect perfection from human beings, it's a lot easier for him to be their leader.
Reading that part, it dawned on me something I'd always felt, that when we go into a country and expect suddenly they're going to be democratic and have the power of the vote, people need to be educated to know what it means.
Connie, you and I are old enough to remember after the Second World War, there was a very popular play on Broadway in New York, Tea House of the August Moon.
Mm-hmm.
It was about American forces occupying the island of Okinawa off Japan. And one of the soldiers says there, we're going to teach these Japanese democracy if we have to shove it down their throats.
Yeah.
That's not the way you do it.
Yeah.
It's like expecting too much of people. And this is what happens in the Bible, that Moses expects people to rise to his level almost instantly. And only when he finds out that's unrealistic, only then does he realize this is going to be a long, slow process.
Along with that, there is the word resilience, and you use that in relation both to Moses and to people who are, as Warren Bennis has written about what leadership is, they fail, but they still get up. It didn't work out. It isn't that I am a loser. It didn't work out.
Connie, you've put your finger on what is perhaps one of the main ideas of the book. You fail, but you're not a failure.
Yeah.
The question is not, did everything work out the way you hoped? The question is, what did you do when things didn't work out the way you hoped? There's that wonderful story I quote from he died all too young, a Professor Philip Simmons, who writes about when he was a child vacationing with his parents in New Hampshire. It was during the summertime, and he said, well, I'll go out and I'll clean the rocks off the road so the road will be smoother. Father says, no, you do that. When the snow comes, it'll turn to slush. It'll become muddy. We need a hard road, not a smooth one.
Yeah.
And I found that such a provocative idea. We, in the same way that people go to the gym and use those resistance machines to make themselves physically strong, we become morally and emotionally strong by having to do difficult things. Make it easy for us, and we will grow up flabby.
Yeah. Promises too. Moses carries Joseph's bones. Why does he do that?
At the very end of the book of Genesis, when Joseph is dying in Egypt, his ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and their wives, were buried in the family crypt at Hebron, the same Hebron which is a flashpoint in the Middle East today. Joseph can't get out to Hebron. The people are going to stay in Egypt. So he makes the Israelites promise, when the time comes for you to leave, take my bones with you and bury them in the promised land. The time comes for them to leave. It's the first Passover, the 10th plague. The Israelites are leaving. All Israel is packing their bags to leave. Moses is busy keeping a promise. I am always so moved by that scene because, you see, Connie, there will be moments in the lives of every single one of us where we will have to choose between doing something for our personal benefit or keeping a promise.
Mm-hmm.
And the person of integrity is the person who says, it's not in my best interest, but I owe it to myself and to the person I promised that I'm going to be.
In your life, where was that?
Oh, a number of times. There was a time where somebody hired me for a job, and then he died and his wife took over, and I hadn't signed anything. I could easily have left. Mm-hmm. But she needed me more because she wasn't as experienced as her late husband was, and I decided to stay and didn't ask for any more money. There were times I could have left my congregation for a larger one, but I was in the middle of trying to do things for people who had learned to depend on me. I suppose I could look at times in my marriage where I had to wonder, do I stay or do I look for something better? And I just felt I made a promise, and I'm the kind of person who keeps promises.
There's a rabbi who has written about his divorce that you talk about in
Perry
the
Netter,
book.
Los Angeles rabbi.
Uh-huh.
And nice fella.
But what was interesting is the fact that people are living longer. And so suddenly at 40, well, if you're going to die at 60, I might as well hang in. But if I'm going to die at 80, that's another half a life.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons I'm finding why there is more divorce. I think you could probably prove this statistically. It would be fascinating to try. Marriages last as long as they did 100 years ago. But 100 years ago, they lasted till one of the parties died.
Yeah.
And now in the 21st century, at that same point, as you were pointing out, people say, I've got half my life ahead of me. Why shouldn't I reach for happiness? I think there may be some other things in there as mm-hmm. well. Expectations, certainly the marriages may not be any less happy in the year 2007, but women have the option of leaving because they can, it's more easily be financially self-sufficient.
I think, too, what happens is the refrigerator wears out, the oven wears out, and they look and they say, well, if I invest in this new one, am I investing with him or her?
I hope we haven't learned to look at our spouses as a machine that's wearing out and it's easier to replace it than to repair it.
There's a wonderful expression I had not heard before that you have in this book, authentic kindness.
Yeah, it's my translation of a Hebrew term, chesed shel emet. Its original meaning is to honor the dead, to sit as a watch person for a deceased body so it's not abandoned, to accompany it to the burial. We had a very sad situation in New York just this week. A man who had been a very prominent leader of the conservative movement unfortunately outlived most of his contemporaries. And when he did die, there was almost nobody left to go to his funeral, and it was so sad. But the attending the funeral, mm-hmm. visiting the mourners, this is a chesed shel emet, a authentic kindness, because sometimes you do a favor in the anticipation that the person will reciprocate.
Yeah.
Do something for a person who dies, and it's pure, pure charity and generosity. There's no way he's going to do it for you.
Yeah. And at that point, you also are writing about surviving loss, about your own going through your son and what it does within the person. And I guess it applies to what Moses loses in his life.
What impresses me most about Moses, and probably the only way in which I will ever have the opportunity to be like Moses. I mean, my books aren't going to be like his books. My career won't be like his career. My impact, no, not nearly like his. To come to the end of one's life and look back at it and see all the things that happened and all the things that didn't happen, things that worked out and things that didn't work out. And then the question is, where do you draw the balance? Do you look back? Connie, I have, as a rabbi, dealt with so many people who were bitter and complaining toward the end of their life because they felt they'd been cheated. They deserved better. And I would try to say to them, you're right. You're right. You deserve better. What are you going to do about it?
Yeah.
All you're doing is making yourself miserable. To the most important thing a person can do as he or she grows older is to purge yourself of all that bitterness and all that resentment and even all that anger at God. There is something absolutely fascinating at the very end of the Torah in the book of Deuteronomy. Moses complains about how God has mistreated him. This is so totally out of character for Moses. He complains to give the Israelites permission to complain and get their anger out against God. And after the Israelites have talked about how angry they are at God, you find something you've never found in the Bible before. It's the most famous verse in the book of Deuteronomy. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your might. Why? You can't love somebody if you're not emotionally honest. If you're angry and you can't admit to the anger, if you feel you have to hide the anger, the wife who's afraid to express her anger at her husband because he may leave her, the husband who doesn't want to spoil things at home by telling his wife that sometimes she really ticks him off, they can't love each other. That's an inauthentic relationship. Only when you can get the anger out and work it through, only then is your emotional relationship honest enough that you can love each other. And only people who are willing to say, sometimes I get angry at God, only those people are going to be able to love God once they've worked through the anger.
I can only say thank you and really bless you for everything you have written to help people live with life and also to live with death, that there is the arc and we all go through it, but don't be your own worst enemy, really. Thank you. Will you autograph my book, Rabbi?
Of course, thanks.
Again, it joins the other wonderful books that you have written, including one of the favorite, The Lord is My Shepherd. If you would like to know what else we have been reading, visit us on the web at www.talksbooks@gmail.com or talksbooks@lycos. We'll tell you in those places what we have been reading, or read our column in the Beverly Hills Courier and support your local library. That's the finest institution you can support. And take a child with you. They'll never forget you. Now, there's a wonderful woman named Judith Cohen, who was one of the women of Apollo. She also has done a great series of books on for young children or young girls. You can be, from even being an animator to being an electrical engineer to being an archaeologist. But this is her story, written by Robin Friend, about how she, with some of these other women, were involved in the astronaut and the Apollo program. It's wonderful illustrations, and you couldn't do better than to give this to young boy or girl, because it is what we all hope for, getting to the moon and surviving. Meanwhile, as I said, support that library, and we'll see you next time. Thank you so very much, Rabbi.
Always a pleasure, Connie.